Hello everyone and welcome to Boundless Dentistry. In this video, we'll talk about condylar hyperplasia. Condyle, which forms the temporomandibular joint, sometimes there is increase in size of the condyle. So in this particular video, we'll talk one of the pathologies of condyle, that is condylar hyperplasia. So let's get started. Now let's begin with talking about what actually is condylar hyperplasia. Now in this picture you can see this is the condyle. We have the mandibular teeth and maxillary teeth. This is the body of the mandible, ramus, coronoid process and the condyle. Now sometimes there is increase in size of this condyle. It can be unilateral or bilateral, but in most cases it's unilateral. As you can see in this picture, this side of the mandible appears to be normal, but this side there is increase in size of this condyle, which you can see. So hyperplasia is basically when there is increase in number of cells, whereas hypertrophy, which is increase in the size of the cells. But in hyperplasia, there is increase in number of cells. So in condylar hyperplasia, there is increase in size of this condyle, which leads to downward movement of this mandible, as you can see in this picture. So this is condylar hyperplasia. This process is pathological. It can affect the condyle, ramus and condyle, or it can even in some cases affect the entire mandible. So there are different variation which changes according to the patients. Now there are certain risk factors which we must keep in mind when we are talking about condylar hyperplasia. That is, sometimes there is trauma associated with the condyle which leads to this condition, hormonal imbalances, environmental factors and genetics. These are risk factors which might lead to development of condylar hyperplasia. One very important condition should be kept in mind when we are talking about condylar hyperplasia, which is osteochondroma. This is a cancerous condition, so it should be differentiated from condylar hyperplasia, which is not a cancerous condition. Now let's move on towards the soft tissue histology of the mandibular condyle. Now when we talked about histology of condyle, there are basically five layers which you can see. First is this fibrous layer which you can see over here. Then there is undifferentiated mesenchyme layer. Next is the pre-hyperplastic cartilage layer. Then we have the hyperplastic cartilage layer. And also you can see these cartilage islands that are present. So this is the normal histology of mandibular condyle. But when we talk about condylar hyperplasia, when a patient has active condylar hyperplasia, this mesenchyme layer which you can see, it is much broader as compared to the normal condyle. So this is a very important layer which we should keep in mind when we are talking about condylar hyperplasia. This layer will broaden when a patient has condylar hyperplasia in active state. Now let's talk about genetics. Insulin growth factor 1 and insulin growth factor 1 receptor, the expression of these two substances has increased in chondrocytes that are affected by condylar hyperplasia. So you should keep in mind the histology for achieving at a diagnosis. And when we talk about in further advanced things, genetics should also be kept in mind. The most widely used classification for defining different types of condylar hyperplasia is defined by Obi-Geisser and McKeag. This is the most commonly used classification for condylar hyperplasia. This is a type 1, which is hemimandibular elongation, type 2 hemimandibular hyperplasia, and type 3, which is combination of these type 1 and type 2. So we'll talk about in detail each of them. Let's begin with talking about hemimandibular elongation with their clinical features. Now firstly, you can see there is displacement of mandible and chin horizontally towards the unaffected side. As you can see here, as the disease is progressing further, the mandible and the chin, it's moving towards the unaffected side. See, it's deviating towards this side. So that is the first clinical feature of hemimandibular elongation. Next, you can also see that the lip line is moving towards the affected side. You can see here it is moving towards this side, and there is mild protrusion as well. So that is the second clinical feature. Third, you can also sometimes appreciate presence of lateral crossed but on the unaffected side, like here. In this case, you cannot appreciate it, but sometimes it is present because as the mandible is deviating towards here, the teeth are also moving towards this side. So these teeth, they move in this direction and these in this direction, which then forms the lateral crossbite. And the midline also deviates towards the unaffected side over here, because this whole side is moving the mandible towards the unaffected side. So the midline is also moving towards this side. So that is the third clinical feature. Now, the occlusal plane is also sloping upwards towards the unaffected side. You can see mandible and the occlusal plane, it is moving in this direction towards the unaffected side. Next, since the mandible is moving towards this direction, there is a gap here. The occlusion is not proper. There is a gap in occlusion between these maxillary and mandibular teeth. Now, to maintain the occlusion, these maxillary teeth, they supra erupt in order to maintain the occlusion. So there is supra eruption of maxillary teeth on the affected side. There is no supra eruption on this side because they are already in contact. In fact, there is a crossbite forming on this side. And lastly, in this picture, you can also appreciate some radiographic finding. You can see the condylar neck, its height is increasing because it's increasing in size, and the head of the condyle is also enlarging. So these are the clinical features of type 1 condylar hyperplasia, that is hemimandibular elongation. Now let's talk about condylar hyperplasia type 2, which is hemimandibular hyperplasia. Now in this case, there is three-dimensional enlargement of the mandible, that is condyle, ramus, neck, body, all of them are affected. Firstly, the abnormal growth, it terminates precisely at the symphysis. So when you feel clinically, you can feel a sharp step over here. So that is the first feature. Then one side of the face is also enlarged, as you can see in this clinical picture. As compared to this side appears enlarged. Clinically, on the affected side, you can also feel a unilateral bowing on the inferior border of the mandible. Next, there is a downward sloping of the affected side. The lip line, it deviates toward the affected side downward. So that is the next clinical feature. When we talk about occlusal discrepancies, we can appreciate lateral open bite on the affected side because there is space created because of the deviation of mandible. There is increased vertical maxillary height on the affected side. And lastly, patient also complains there is something wrong with their TMJ because obviously there is functional disturbances, so that leads to TMJ pain as well. Now let's talk about hemimandibular hyperplasia's radiology. First, you can see this is the affected side. You can see the side of condyle, it is so enlarged as compared to this normal condyle. So it's easily appreciable, the two condyles. You can see the entire half of the mandible, it's enlarged. Also, you can see this ID canal that is running, it's also displaced towards the lower border of the mandible. So that is the first feature you can appreciate. You can also see elongation of the ramus. If you can see this ramus, this is large as compared to this. Next, you can also see that the condylar neck, it's elongating and it's thickened. You can see this is the neck, it has elongated, it also thickened as compared to this. Next, you can also see there is irregular deforming enlargement of the condyle only unilaterally. Here there is no such enlargement present. All these features which we have talked about here in this OPG, you can also see in this radiological picture as well. So these features are pathognomic of patients presenting with hemimandibular hyperplasia. Now let's talk about other problems that patients with condylar hyperplasia face. There is aesthetic problems which we appreciate it clinically, which is disturbing to the patient. When patients present with condylar hyperplasia, their occlusion is also affected. So when that's the case, they have open bite, lateral cross bite, protrusion of teeth. So when that is the case, their mastication is impaired. Due to impaired mastication and aesthetics and the occlusion not being proper, they present with poor oral hygiene, which then predisposes them to caries and periodontal problems. Because of impaired aesthetics and functional disturbances, this further leads to psychological problems. Impaired mastication then further leads to TMJ problems, and when patient is not having a proper diet, all of this affects digestion. So these are the problems that are accompanied in patients suffering from condylar hyperplasia. Now, to reach a definitive diagnosis of condylar hyperplasia, differentiate it from osteochondroma, we first perform clinical examination, which we just talked about in clinical features. Then we go for radiographs, just we have discussed right now, nuclear imaging, CT scan, PET scan. We also perform one specific test that is called as single proton emission CT. Now, what do we do in this particular test? As you can see in this radiographical picture, we check the active growth of mandible. We inject this technetium methyl diphosphonate is injected and it is absorbed in the bones. Now, how do we differentiate between a pathological and normal growth of condyle? We check the difference in the radiographically. As you can see, this is where the problem lies. If the difference between the two condyle is more than 10%, so that means that the patient is suffering from condylar hyperplasia. So this single proton emission CT is a really specific test to reach a diagnosis of condylar hyperplasia. So this is how we'll perform the diagnosis and then reach our definitive diagnosis. Now, talking about the histology of a patient that is actually suffering from condylar hyperplasia, firstly, there is irregular thickening of bony trabeculae. You can see it histologically. Next, like we talked before, the mesenchyme layer, it thickens in patients suffering from condylar hyperplasia. So there is uninterrupted layer, it broadens, as you can see in this histological slide. There is hypertrophic cartilage because the entire condyle, it's enlarging. So the size of the cartilage also increases, as you can see, all of these layers are increasing. There are islands of chondrocytes in subchondral trabecular bone. You can see these islands that are present all over here. This is the next histological feature. And lastly, there is increased thickness of cartilaginous layer. You can see these are cartilaginous layer that is present. Its thickness increased. So these are the histological features you should keep in mind when talking about condylar hyperplasia. Now, after talking about clinical features, histology, radiology, different type of diagnosis, problems, now lastly, we talk about the patient has been diagnosed with condylar hyperplasia. Now, how do we treat it? Now, the treatment mainly depends on patient's clinical features and whether the growth of mandible, the condyle, is active or it has been ceased. So, when we have decided on these factors, next we talk about what are the objectives of our treatment for this patient suffering from condylar hyperplasia. We have to eradicate the pathogenesis first. What is actually causing the patient to develop this particular condition? And then we try to achieve optimal function, that is the patient can chew and have proper TMJ function. And also the clinical features, the aesthetics that were disturbed, we have to restore it back. And lastly, sometimes patient might require TMJ procedure, which either can be performed with this or it can also be performed separately. But most commonly, it is performed with high condylectomy along with it. Now, the first treatment option for condylar hyperplasia is condylectomy. Condylectomy, that means removal of condyle. It is mostly indicated for patients suffering from active condylar hyperplasia. Now, what is high condylectomy? In this high condylectomy, certain portion of this condyle is removed using pre-auricular approach or some mandibular endoscopic technique. We create an incision and then we have a direct look at the condyle, and when we have seen the hyperplastic portion of the condyle, superiorly around 4 to 5 mm of this condyle, we remove it. And what is the purpose of removing this? So that we can arrest the growth. That is why it is known as high condylectomy, because in higher superior portion of the condyle, we remove the part of condyle in order to arrest the growth. Now, TMJ function after we perform condylectomy, it is not affected as much because there is no disc displacement, patient normally don't develop any myofascial pain. So this is one of the treatment options for condylar hyperplasia, which is condylectomy. Next treatment option that is present is condylectomy along with orthodontic surgery. We perform condylectomy, removal of some part of condyle, and then we might also perform orthodontic surgery, because in some patient there is some protrusion of the teeth or mandible or even maxilla. So in that cases we might perform this orthodontic surgery in order to improve function and aesthetics. First we perform condylectomy and then we perform orthodontic surgery in order to correct occlusal discrepancies such as open bite, cross bite and some of the things that we've discussed before. So this is the second treatment option, that is condylectomy along with orthodontic surgery. Now the last treatment option is mandibular ramus osteotomy of affected condyle. What are the indications of performing this particular treatment option? That is patient with severe pronatic profile. Pronatic means that the mandible is moved in this front direction and the maxilla is present behind. Normally maxilla is present in front of mandible, so when patient have pronatic profile we should perform this treatment option. And also in patient with excessive rotation of unaffected condyle. In this case, we can also combine it with Lefort 1 in order to correct occlusal discrepancy. So in these indications, we perform mandibular ramus osteotomy of affected condyle. So in this video, we talked about what is condylar hyperplasia, the different types of condylar hyperplasia, the classification. Then we talk about histology of normal condyle and compared it with condylar hyperplasia. Then we talk about radiology, different diagnostic tools that are used for patient affected with condylar hyperplasia, some problems associated with condylar hyperplasia in patients that they suffer from, and then lastly we talked about the different treatment options that are available for patients suffering from this particular pathology. So I hope this video was useful for you, and if you like this video, please like, share, subscribe and press the bell icon. Thank you for watching this video. See you next time.